I'm Molly McCauley. I'm RFF's Vice President for Research. I'm standing in for our President Phil Sharp, who is almost always here. Today, unfortunately, he had an out-of-town commitment, but he sends his best. It's also important to note that RFF is co-hosting this discussion today with the Stanford Woods Institute. And this is the second in a series of seminars on Arctic issues co-hosted with the Woods Institute. And for that partnership, I'm very grateful on behalf of RFF, so thank you. The Arctic. This is a region that people describe using superlatives. It contains some of the most unique communities, economies, and cultures in the world, adapted to the northernmost part of the Earth. It's got sizable natural resources, freshwater, fish, minerals, oil, gas, forests, if we include the subarctic. It's one of the last and most extensive continuous wildernesses in the world. It's this approximate limit of the midnight sun and the polar night. And you probably know this, but I didn't. But if the atmospheric conditions are right, it's so cold that the sound waves bend towards the surface, and you can hear conversations up to 3 kilometers away. So I mentioned today that our event is part of a series. In April 2014, which was one of the anniversaries of the Deepwater Horizon spill, because RFF had contributed significantly to the President's Commission in the aftermath of the spill, RFF held a seminar on Are There Lessons Learned from the Deepwater Horizon Experience that would help inform energy development in the Arctic. And at that time, joining us were Fran Ulmer, Don Bosch, Bob Gagosian, Beth Kertula, and others. In April 2015, with the Woods Institute, we jointly held another seminar on reforming offshore energy leasing in the Arctic. This included representatives from the Interior Department, the State Department, and Willie Goodwin, the former mayor of Kotzba, Alaska, and the chair of the Arctic Waterways Safety Committee there. The videos from those events are on our web, and the video from today will be on our web probably by Friday for further reference or sharing with colleagues. The common theme for the Woods Institute and the RFF work in these areas is as follows. There's a conviction that we have as scholars in these two communities at Stanford and RFF, that research really can inform regulatory design and natural resource management, especially when there are risks and uncertainties about natural systems, economic industrial sectors, investments, and economic well-being. Those who know RFF and Woods know that we know these trade-offs matter, and that's the kind of thing we research. So today we have another distinguished panel, Alan Krupnik, my colleague here at RFF, who co-leads our Center for Energy and Climate, will serve as moderator. But before I introduce Alan, I want to thank Katrina McLaughlin of RFF and Lee Rosenbaum and Ashley Erickson of the Woods Institute. Their leadership brought us together today, and for that I'm very grateful, so thank you so much. As I mentioned, Alan will serve as moderator. He'll introduce our distinguished panelists. He'll also manage the Q&A, which is really important. Your dialogue with us is why we have these public events here at RFF. And he'll wrap us up as promptly as he can at 2 o'clock. So with no further ado, let me step aside and thank you, Alan, for joining us.
Thank you, Molly. Before I forget, those of you who are listening on the webinar, you can, listening and the internet out there, you can just reach us with questions at hashtag AskRFF. So, and then I have a tablet over here, and I'll get them and try to sort them out to ask the panelists questions. So, you know, when I think about shipping in the Arctic, I have this very romantic notion of ships linking the Atlantic and the Pacific through the Northwest Passage. And I think most people in the media, probably not the people here, think of that as well. But what we're talking about primarily here with increased shipping is increased destination shipping. So this is shipping that's servicing activities that are already going on in the Alaskan part of the Arctic, or things are activities that might actually grow, or even new activities that might be made more economic by cheaper shipping, cheaper because it's less risky, because of the melting, earlier melting of ice, and also longer servicing times because, again, less ice to stop that shipping from occurring. So we think that now's a really good time to talk about this topic because it follows up on President Obama's recent trip to Alaska to spotlight the impacts of climate change. But some of you might say, well, why are you really talking about this with what recently happened with Shell Oil when they pulled out for the foreseeable future from their exploration of wells for oil in the Chukchi Sea. But the melting is going to continue, the shipping is going to grow, and that's why we're here talking about it, irrespective of what happened with Shell. And Shell may go back in before you know it. So while this increased shipping is going to help development, it does carry risks with it. It brings noise and sonar effects on species. It brings pollution, including just your conventional air pollutants in a very pristine environment, as well as black carbon, which can reduce the reflectivity of sunlight into space and cause further warming. It can introduce invasive species. It can involve damage to whales from ship strikes and dispersal of fish. And it conflicts with native communities. So two more interesting ones are the noise could drive the fish further away from shore, making it harder to catch them. And the wakes from the ships could influence the small boats that are used to catch the fish in the first place from native communities. So our purposes today are to examine the science and the policies associated with shipping in the Alaskan part of the Arctic. What do we know about these impacts from a science perspective? How will they change with increased warming and melting of ice? And how can these impacts be prepared for and mitigated? So that's what we're about. And we have a great panel to look at these issues, a really distinguished, knowledgeable panel. First up is going to be Jerry Goldbogen, or Goldbogen, Jeremy, not sure. He's an assistant professor of biology at Stanford, and he runs a blog on whales. And he writes, for instance, that whales don't, I don't know if you have this picture, but I have this picture of whales kind of slowly moving around the ocean with their mouths open, just gobbling up whatever's available. And he shows that the whales actually are much more efficient than that, and they're lunging at, you know, balls of prey. So they do a pretty good, efficient job at it. So anyway, Jeremy's going to examine the effects of shipping on whales and other species and approaches for mitigation. Then next is going to be Lawson Brigham, who, aside from being sort of the Arctic shipping expert and showed that from his chairing the Arctic Marine Shipping Assessment of several years ago, which he'll talk about, he's a former captain of the Coast Guard. We have two captains of the Coast Guard here, who has commanded icebreakers and was recognized as reaching the furthest navigable places at the Earth's northernmost and southernmost extremes, which is pretty special. And Lawson's going to provide background on this issue and mechanisms to address the issues. Next will be the Honorable Denise Michaels. She's the first Native American mayor of the city of Nome. And Nome is a center for some activity associated with shipping, and Denise, I'm sure, will tell us about that. And she participates in a variety of activities on this topic and other related topics. She's going to provide the community perspective to us, I think. And then finally, Captain Scott Smith, he's the chief of the Office of Navigation Systems at the Coast Guard, and he'll inform us about what the Guard is planning to do to support and prepare for increased shipping. So with that, each of our panelists is going to come up here and talk for 10 to 12 minutes in turn, and then we'll bring them all up here for a Q&A. Now, Jeremy, you've noticed there are only three chairs and three names up here. Jeremy is actually couldn't make it and is going to be on the phone. So I'm hoping, Jeremy, you're right there right now.
Correct. Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
All right. So let's make sure he's loud enough for everyone to hear. And maybe I should work your slides. Oh, you're doing it over there? Okay. All right. We've got your slides covered, too. So take it away.
All right. Thank you very much, Alan. Much appreciated. Thank you for that introduction. And thank you very much to RFF and the Woods Institute for the invitation to speak to you today. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the research that we've been doing off the coast of California, specifically on the baseline biology of some of the great whales off our coastline, and also how that biology is impacted by human activities with a focus on interactions with ships. So on this slide, if you could go back, yes, to the slide with the tags, please. Slide number two. Okay, so these are the technologies that we use to understand what whales are doing underwater. So 95% of the time, these whales are beneath the ocean surface, and we can't see them directly. So this is the technology that we use to track them in three dimensions and also to listen to the environment. So there are underwater microphones in these tags that allow us to listen to the ocean and any noise that might be in the ocean as well. And so these are called archival tags, and they have fine scale resolution movement sensors in them. So an intuitive way to think about this is that whenever you take your iPhone and you move it 90 degrees, the screen will move with you. And so those are little accelerometers in your phone that can tell the phone its orientation relative to gravity. So we use that same basic principle here to continuously monitor and quantify the orientation of whales when they're underwater. And so as you can see in the picture on the right, these tags are attached to a long carbon fiber pole, and we deploy these tags on whales as they're surfacing. So if you could move to the next slide, we have a video here that shows this process in action. And so these are with my colleagues Ari Friedlander from Oregon State University and John Kalamakidis from the Cascadia Research Collective. And of course, this video shows when everything goes perfectly. It's not always that easy. But we deploy these tags, and the tags can stay on from anywhere from a few hours to a day or two. And we get a lot of information back. And if you could move to the next slide, I'm showing a map here of where we've been deploying these types of tags up and down the California coast, not only in national marine sanctuaries, but also near very busy ports where there's a lot of shipping activity. And so we've been deploying these tags on some of the largest baleen whale species, for example, blue whales, fin whales, and humpback whales, all up and down the California coast. And on the next slide, I'm going to show you just some example data from the tags. And so this shows three deep foraging dives from a blue whale. And so on the vertical axis, you can see the depth. So this whale is diving deep to find food deep, 250 meters deep into the ocean. And these are three dives that take 45 minutes. And so if you could just move to the next slide, and it'll highlight that middle dive. I just want to put the ecological context onto this dive. And on the next slide, it's going to show you where these animals are going and why they are diving so deep. They're actually diving in search of these really dense aggregations of krill. And these are really extraordinary, very, very deep and very dense pancake-like layers of krill. These are small shrimp-like organisms that some of these whales almost exclusively feed on. And this shows you the extent to which these animals are diving and feeding for food. And on the next slide, summarizing the really fine-scale kinematics of how these animals are diving and feeding for food. If you go to the next slide here, there should be a three-dimensional animation just to give you an idea of the complexity of these whale behaviors. And now the whale is at the sea surface diving. It almost looks like there is a roller coaster. These are the trajectories that these animals are doing as they are feeding. And on the next slide, we're also getting new perspectives using animal-attached video tags, and so we can actually get a visual confirmation for all the fine-scale data that these tags are providing with us. And so what you're seeing here, you're literally riding on the back of a blue whale, and this blue whale has targeted a little patch of krill and is going to lunge and feed and basically swallow up a large volume of krill-laden water. And if you were to look at snapshots of that video on the next slide, You could actually see that the krill patch is actually rotating in the view of the camera, and based on the movement sensors, we can actually reconstruct these really acrobatic maneuvers as these whales are spinning around, basically doing barrel rolls or pirouettes underwater. And I show this because it shows, again, the extraordinary extent to which these animals are doing these amazing maneuvers just to get the really, really best patch of krill. And on the next slide, this really reinforces this fundamental aspect of these whales' life history. They really need these dense krill patches in order to feed their really gigantic body size. And these dense krill patches are located really close to our shores, and it's one reason why these animals are so close to our activities and why sometimes these baseline biological activities might be impacted by human activities such as shipping. And on the next slide, I'm going to highlight basically two case studies that show how these biological processes of these whales are affected by anthropogenic sound, specifically mid-frequency sonar, and also interactions with ships. And so I just want to mention that a lot of this, technology and also the funding for a lot of this fieldwork has been made possible by the U.S. Navy, specifically the Office of Naval Research. And so on the next slide, want to introduce to you the Behavioral Response Study, which is a multi-year project off the coast of California, and our purpose is to not only understand baseline whale behavior, but also to see whether that behavior is affected by mid-frequency sounds that are used in a lot of military contexts. And on the next slide, showing an example of what our experiment looks like. So it's pretty simple. We tag a whale, and then we expose the whale to simulated sounds that are very similar to military sonar. And what you're seeing in that video there is that whale was deep feeding, and as soon as it was experiencing mid-frequency sonar, it stopped feeding and went to the surface, looked towards the surface, and then started to swim away. And on the next slide, this is a summary of that data that was just shown in that video. And you can see how on the bottom left panel, you can see how that animal is feeding deeply. And as soon as the animal experienced sonar, which is indicated in the red circles there, the animal stopped feeding and moved to the sea surface. And on the next slide, we also have some data showing that these whales make their own calls, and these whales use these calls in order to communicate to other animals. And we think this might be a way for animals to tell each other where the good food is, where those really good dense krill patches are. And on the next slide, I'm showing one example where we exposed a calling whale to mid-frequency sound. Every dot on that figure there represents when we detected a whale's call, and then you can see highlighted in red when we exposed this fin whale to mid-frequency sound, and you can see how that calling behavior was affected. On the next slide, here's another example of how this whale calling behavior can be affected. They can be masked by other types of sounds in the ocean, whether they're human-based or naturally based. So in the bottom left of that figure, you can see blue whale calls that are these little bright dots. And then you can see the acoustic signature of the passing ship and how that is essentially masking those blue whale calls. On the next slide, switching gears now into looking at more the interaction, the physical interaction between whales and ships, there's increasing concern that an increase in shipping traffic may be associated with the increased number of whale strikes that we're observing on our coast. And if you think about the speed at which these animals are capable of compared to the typical speeds of these ships, which are on the order of 10 to 12 meters per second, there might be some worry about whether these animals can get out of the way of the ship, and that is all dependent on whether they can actually detect them. On the next slide, we've been looking at where whales are located specifically in relation to the shipping lanes in Southern California. Every dot there shows the location of these whales, where they're feeding, for example. And the cause for concern are where these feeding areas overlap with these shipping lanes. On the next slide, we're showing some tag data of how the whales are behaving in relation to these shipping lanes. Specifically in that upper right figure there, we can see when these animals are feeding, and even at night when they're closer to the surface, they can often drift into these shipping lanes. On the next slide, I'm just going to quickly document several direct measurements where we've documented a close ship-whale interaction. And of course, as you can see, all of these interactions that we've directly observed have occurred in these shipping lanes. Next slide, please. And hopefully this video will work. This shows the simultaneous interaction between whale and ship. Not seeing the video working on my end, but if you go to the next slide, it shows a summary data table here. Yes, right there. And what we have found is that these whales have a very muted response to ships. They're not very agile and capable of recognizing ships as a potential threat. And so they have a very muted response, and they essentially sink away from these ships very, very slowly. It's one of the reasons why we're able to get tags on with a lot of certainty, because these whales are not really, have evolved to sense these ships as a threat. And so on the next slide, I hope I've been able to convince you that although we've demonstrated some significant changes in behavior related to these human activities, we need to do a lot more research to actually quantify the severity and whether these are actually biologically significant and may impact these populations in a significant way. And thank you very much for your patience, and I'm sorry you can't be there in person today. And please email me with any questions that you might have related to this research. Thank you very much.
Oh, well, thank you, Jeremy. That was great. Let's give him a round of applause. I think he can hear. I learned a lot. That's great. So thanks, and I hope things go well for you. So the next, our next speaker is Lawson. So come on up.
I thought a couple slides might be useful for trying to introduce what's actually going on in the Arctic. And you read the global media, and there are different takes on it. We're all going to go into war in the Arctic, et cetera, right? So what's going on in the Arctic? Well, of course, profound Arctic climate change, the epicenter of climate change perhaps on the planet, along with the Antarctic. So that relates to shipping, greater access, potentially longer seasons of navigation. But I'll tell you and echo what you said already. The profound changes in sea ice are not retooling the global trade routes. Why? Because the place is ice covered. Through the century, for 7.5 months, partially or fully ice covered. So just that cover will control the levels of shipping. So we can all agree, I think, it's all going to be seasonal. Whatever it is, transarctic destinational, it's seasonal. But that's not what I read in the global media wherever I go. I read, of course, that Mr. Putin is going to replace the Suez Canal with the Northern Sea Route. Well, I would say good luck. I don't know what century, how long he's going to be the president of Russia, but what century that will happen. But globalization of the Arctic relates to shipping, of course. It's the relationship of Arctic natural resources to global markets. And the mechanism to do that, other than pipelines, of course, is ships. And really, the fundamental finding of the Arctic Marine Shipping Assessment of the Arctic Council was it's not sea ice driving the great change in Arctic shipping or marine operations. It's clearly the linkage of global markets to these precious resources that are in fairly high quantities up in the top of the world. And of course, we can't divorce the Arctic from global geopolitics and Ukraine, et cetera. It's all linked. But I think the Arctic Council and the Arctic states are trying their best to keep a peaceful arrangement and develop cooperation at the highest level. And one area, at least in the Arctic Council, is on shipping issues. And Arctic shipping kind of is the wrong term for this, I think. We might have liked to have changed the title of the Arctic Marine Shipping Assessment to the Arctic Marine Use Assessment, but it was too late. And Arctic shipping to many people, most people in the media, is a tanker or maybe a bulk carrier, but for the rest of us might be a cruise ship or a large fishing vessel. So it's all marine operations is what we're talking about, because the impacts come from a full range of different types of marine operations. You think offshore development and Shell's Armada, I mean, that's marine shipping at the highest order. 20, 30 ships, all having very specialized operations that they conduct to support one drilling site is quite extraordinary. And the thousands, if not hundreds, of transits of that armada of ships brings us tremendous impact, potential impact, in the coastal area around the rig, maybe 100 miles away, maybe real close. And then finally, maybe I should have put this first, Denise, it's indigenous peoples issues, full range of issues from rights to impacts to climate change, all relate to this marine shipping, Arctic marine shipping topic. What's in the Arctic that people want? And here's at least one graphic. 10% of the world's fisheries is in the Arctic, and things like palladium and nickel, fifth of the world's nickel is in the Arctic, and most of it in Norilsk. Diamonds, palladium, zinc. Most of the 10% of the zinc is in one of the two largest zinc mines in the world. One is the Red Dog mine in Alaska. So 10% of the world's zinc is sitting in our state. Denise is in my state. So that's quite significant. And it's shipping from the Red Dog mine, from Kivalina, some of the world's largest, physically large bulk carriers, go from Kivalina to Southeast Asia, to smelters at BC. So it's a global connection, a global commodity, all done for a short window of time, 2.5-3 months a year, 30 vessels maybe. But the remarkable thing is they are among the largest vessels in the world. And of course, all the cargo is lifted by lighters. I mean, it's not the most efficient operation in the world because there's no port there. It's just a place. But it's a fascinating connection to global markets. And of course, global, you know, the iconic USGS study that says the Arctic is a gas province, but there's some oil. Well, thankfully, I guess there's some, maybe not as much as we hope, in the Beaufort and Chukchi Sea. But of course, there's oil in the Kara Sea, and so there are pockets of oil, and that relates to the shipping. Now, the Arctic has estimated 25% of the world's rare earths. So you hear about China and kind of capitalize on the rare earths market, so that's an issue. And for us in the AMSA, I mean, fresh water, we were trying to be paint some plausible futures. There's a lot of fresh water in the Arctic. Canada, Russia, the United States, and Alaska, we bottle fresh water and send it to Japan. You know that around the planet, ships bring cargoes of fresh water to places like Barcelona. So it is very highly plausible that bulk carriage of water could happen in the Arctic. Sounds a little bizarre. Sounds related, kind of like the towing of the icebergs from Antarctica to Saudi Arabia, but it isn't. It's more plausible than that, we think. And it's a global commodity, which probably have been conferences here and workshops that talk about the new global commodity might not be oil, it's fresh water. A lot of fresh water in the Arctic. How would it be carried here? Pipeline to Chicago, maybe from Canada. I'm not sure Canada would like that, but ships to places that need fresh water. And, of course, the tourism industry is a niche market, but that's part of shipping in the Arctic and in trade. Just a couple passive microwave images from 79 and then the minimum extent of September 20th, 2012, which is still the minimum of sea ice cover, but you can see all the darkness and all the openness, but this is only at the minimum extent. And most of the year is, of course, partially or fully ice covered. But nonetheless, you see that the real openness is on the Russian side, on the Eurasian side, to the right in these images. But I think this is what is missed by the global media, what we've talked about, that the place is ice covered. These are average of passive microwave images for the last two seasons. And you can see it's about 2,200 nautical miles across the top of the world from Bering Strait to Fram Strait into the Atlantic. Places ice covered for 8 months out of the year today, likely to be ice covered for 7.5 months. Now the ice is thinner, there's less extent, the character of the ice has changed, you can more easily break it if there's no multi-year, all of that profound, but still ice cover for 2,000 nautical miles on top of the world. So that's why the new global trade routes will likely all be destinational. A couple of modeling efforts, UCLA graduate student, PhD student, and Larry Smith and most of us today, this is what the picture looks like today. Again, it's on the Eurasian side, the Northern Sea Route, potential for increased traffic. I did put a number up there. There only have been 236 transits of vessels from Roland Amundsen from 1906 to this season, and 150 are adventurous. So the Northwest Passage, with those kinds of numbers throughout history, it's pretty low. There have been a couple cargo ships, the Manhattan, of course, recent couple cargo ships, but it's not likely, and we don't see in the people that study this subject, that the Northwest Passage is really a viable route anytime in the near term. But the Northern Sea Route, of course, is the... Now, let's take this out mid-century. Larry Smith and his team see potential for maybe Transarctic right across the top of the world, but only in a window of time in September, late August, September. So we're talking about summertime potential, and if you can retool your global fleet to handle this and spot charters or whatever, the Arctic Ocean will be very open for a window of time in the summer for Transarctic navigation. Of course, it's open for destinational traffic, a lot of traffic, but traffic today in the United States Maritime Arctic, well, 2013, but you can see into Kivalina. You can see, let's see here, is this right? Oh, this is Kivalina, so you see orange cargo ships going into there. You see along the Northern Sea Route around Chukotka, northeast Russia here, tankers, bulk carriers, cargo ships. But all you see around the United States Maritime Arctic in 2013, tugs and barges that link to the North Slope and to coastal communities. So the majority of traffic in the United States Maritime Arctic and into the future is all related to barge traffic. Now let me show you what the traffic is prior to this in the wintertime. There's no traffic in the United States Maritime Arctic. So, I mean, I don't want to be too cynical, but it's seasonal, right? The traffic is seasonal. It's seasonal in the Russian Arctic. Well, my Russian friends here will say it's seasonal. Makes sense, right? It is correlated with the advance and retreat of the seasonal ice cover. So, you know, lots of traffic, but you know, when you look at, I mean, it looks like a lot of traffic, but the maximum number of ships in Bering Strait in August on one day, three ships, hardly matches the, let's say, the English Channel. So we're gearing up, very good to gear up routes and restrictions, but the levels of traffic are modest at best, but important to take care of the environment, protect our people, that's for sure. Oops, let me go back. Well, you know that many of us and several in the audience have worked on this AMSA. We did have scenarios, and the scenarios pointed out for plausible futures, all driven by resource development and then either much governance or lack of governance. That was our axes, but you can see the topics that we covered. The ship here is an ice-breaking carrier that works a shuttle system between the Pechora Sea and Murmansk. And you can see the topics that we dealt with. We reached out in some 15 different working groups, working meetings out in indigenous communities. So it was an important document of the Arctic Council. Most important element of it is that the Arctic states reached consensus on 17 recommendations. In fact, Captain Malcolm Williams is in the audience. Malcolm, put your hand up. He and I kind of dreamed up these themes. You remember we're drinking coffee. We said, how are we going to, what? Because we said, well, obviously the marine safety stuff is related to IMO, polar codes, all of that. Protecting Arctic people, oil spills, cetaceans and all that. But the real issue in the Arctic, at least equal to these, no infrastructure. The only infrastructure in the Arctic today, or Arctic maritime world, coast of Iceland, coast of Norway, not Svalbard, and northwest Russia. We don't have any infrastructure in the United, well, other than Mayor Denise's port, but it's a shallow port, we'll say. So it's not a deep port, but there is infrastructure, but not of the level that can connect to the global maritime world. So these three themes covered all of the, and the next graphic is a bit noisy. It's kind of what has taken place. We have a SAR agreement by the Arctic states, an oil spill preparedness and response agreement by the Arctic states, facilitated by the Arctic Council. We have new IMO polar code coming for ships operating in polar waters. We've linked it to indigenous communities. So you can see there's a range of activities. The AMSA is still alive and well because the AMSA is a framework of action to protect the environment and people by the Arctic states. So all Arctic states are on board, and there have been three implementation status reports, which keeps this framework alive. And then just a couple comments, and I'll finish. On the polar code is a lot of stuff. Ship safety equipment, responding to MARPOL annexes on oil, noxious liquids, training and expertise. Now, there's a lot of heat brought to bear on that the IMO polar code doesn't cover anything, and that's quite true. It doesn't cover black carbon, doesn't cover lots of emission issues. If we wanted to wait for another 20 years, I was part of the U.S. delegation at IMO, we might have a polar code that would include all of that. But all of that will come. This is the baseline document, and it is seminal. Other than UNCLOS, it is a really seminal historic framework for protecting the Arctic. Of course, it only covers large ships, 500 tons or more of cargo carriers and cruise ships. But it is a host. It requires a polar certificate. Well, if you pull into Nuuk and the Danish law enforcement people come aboard, or Nome and the Coast Guard people come aboard, you don't have your little certificate. You're not sailing up into Arctic waters because they're not going to let you sail north. You go south. So I think there are some mechanisms to hear. The question is on IMO, on any IMO convention, how do you do the law enforcement? Well, it's a flag state thing, but it's also port state control too. The diagram, you know, of the application of the polar code. It's 60 north in our part of the world in Alaska. So all the ships that are up there in the summertime are above the polar code, like national security cutters and other ships. How do they meet polar code? Even though government vessels don't have to, but of course the regulators are friendly Coast Guard people. So the challenges of the polar code are many. Classification societies and the insurance companies are intimately involved in implementation of the polar code. Where are the mariners coming from? What's the role of the EU in all of this, and the Arctic states themselves, port state control, et cetera, and monitoring and tracking, domain awareness, data assessment, and all of that, huge issue. And then the polar code is only one important seminal piece of all this infrastructure stuff. Think about training of mariners and all that. That's all infrastructure. At least that's what we called it in. And then finally, last slide, I think some of the things we might talk about here, uniform application. We do want all the Arctic states in particular to have uniform application of the polar code. Polar code doesn't speak to fishing vessels or smaller vessels. It may in the future. Of course, the black carbon issue is huge. Perhaps I would say that there'll be an Arctic emissions control area sometime down the road in the Arctic. And then finally, how does the polar code, how is that integrated and enforced in MPAs, PSSAs, protected areas, items that we might talk about with Q&As? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Lawson. So you're up, Ms. Mayor.
Thank you for the invitation. It's an honor to speak with you today on Arctic issues. It's one of my key passions. I'd just like to put this up just to remind folks how big the state of Alaska is, and the distance from Kodiak to Nome is about 800 miles, and so it's a long way. The Bering Straits region in northwest Alaska, we have 17 cities and 21 tribes. The land base size is about the size of West Virginia. There are no roads to Nome, although we would like a road to Nome. There are a couple of roads within our communities, but the only way to get in and out is through the airlines, which, if the weather's good. And then, of course, our goods come in through a barge during the season from the end of May to the end of October. Subsistence is very important. It's our way of life, it's our tradition, it's our cultures, and it ties us together. It provides our nutrition. I just wanted to show a couple samples here. Marine Mammal Protection Act, Alaska Natives are the only group to subsist marine mammals, and under ANILCA, under Title VIII, gives a preference, subsistence priority preference to Alaska Natives. So the fish, reindeer, caribou, we use all of the products. So there's a little boy, a picture of a little boy way over there. That's a bird feather, bird skin parka from St. Lawrence Island. And then he's wearing traditional ivory sun goggles. And then, of course, we had a Quirk had their regional conference, and we held a fashion show. And so you can see a lot of the skins we use to keep our bodies warm during our hunting. Climate change. We've had more 20-year event storms in the last 10 years. I've counted, I think, four of them. If we were in the tropics, they would be considered the 2011 one, a Category 3 hurricane. So the storms are very strong and powerful, and our communities are very vulnerable. Six of our communities are threatened by erosion. This is from the University of Fairbanks, just showing you some of the typical erosion issues that we're dealing with. The 2004 storm washed out our road, so it's also very expensive to adapt and to build back, and looking at different engineering methods to keep our permafrost cool. The Coast Guard, I always have to give my shout out to my Coast Guard folks here. We continue to advocate for more Coast Guard presence, especially when these storms happen. If a vessel is in distress, there is port clearance for a place of refuge, but there is no other port, as Lawson said, and we have a medium draft port at minus 22 feet. And so it's really important to have their presence in the Arctic. We do have a gold rush happening in Nome, and this is in state waters in front of us. And I don't know if you've seen the Bering Sea gold on the Discovery Channel. It's very interesting that resource is still out there, and they continue to mine, and they do it also under the ice in the winter. Just some data numbers for you. 1930, the Port of Nome, down on the bottom left, there was mere 34 vessels. Last year, we had 446. The yellow, you see vessels waiting to come into our Port of Nome. Besides destinational traffic, we have cruise ships, we have ships that sail the Northwest Passage, and then foreign vessels. We have the Canadian Coast Guard, the Korean icebreaker, our own Coast Guard folks there. So their drafts are too deep, and so that's what the yellow shows is. Of the vessels waiting to come in, about 34 of their drafts are too deep for them to come to the Port of Nome. If you haven't heard, we had an international event, I think you would call it, with a historic delivery of fuel with the Renda and the Healy, just to show how close they were able to come in. We had no idea that our waters had changed, and NOAA just got through mapping our in front of our harbor, and we were really surprised that we're a lot deeper than we thought, and we want to thank NOAA for that work, and of course the Coast Guard for bringing the fuel in the winter. We're all talking about the Port of Nome. This is by the Corps. There's no music. We passed a milestone, and with Shell pulling out, I think it's more important now that we need the assets in place. There is no offshore assets when Shell pulled out. There was, if there was a ship in distress, they had all the vessels there that could go and help. Now there's nothing. And I think that's the one important message that we need to bring across to folks, that the infrastructure is needed, and we're looking forward to working with our congressional delegation and the Corps to make this improvement. It's a national security issue, search and rescue, and environmental response. It's really needed. We've also identified a gap in U.S. Arctic policy, which calls for an Arctic deep draft port. Unfortunately, the Corps of Engineers Harbor Sim program goes on the cost-benefit ratio analysis. And so it identified the current port at minus 28, when by definition 33 USC, I think it's 2241, a deep draft port is at minus 45 at least. The Corps study in 2013 called for a deep draft port in Nome at minus 36. So we're looking forward to working with the ambassador and the Office of Technology and the Arctic Executive Committee to find out how we can address that gap. We've also spent $11 million on a new dock to help bring that traffic in. It should be done now, and it was on time and on budget. That was amazing. You never hear that, on time and on budget. So there are other items I could answer questions later, but it's been an honor to talk with you, and we continue to be engaged at the process at the table, because the decisions that are made here in D.C. reflect us directly, those that live there. So thank you.
Okay, so now we have our last speaker, Captain Smith.
Good afternoon. It's an honor to be here. I think the Woods Institute and the Resource of Future for inviting me here. Denise, I can definitely have a personal story about the size of Alaska. I had the fortune of commanding a cutter out of Southeast Alaska, and my buddy of mine was anchored or stationed up at Kodiak, and my wife had said when we got orders, oh, we'll be able to go visit Paul. I said, you realize that's 900 miles, right? with planes, trains, and no roads to get there. So it's great to be here. The Coast Guard's been involved in Alaska since 1867. Then, as of now, our mission is to enforce U.S. laws and regulations, conduct search and rescue, assist scientific exploration, and foster navigation safety and environmental stewardship. Coast Guard signed its Arctic strategy in May of 2013 to ensure safe, secure, and environmentally responsible maritime activity in the Arctic. Three main pillars of the Coast Guard's strategy are improving awareness, modernizing governance, and broadening partnerships. Coast Guard's identified 13 initiatives to implement the Coast Guard's Arctic strategy, and I'm only going to really talk about one here today in my presentation, and that's promoting waterways management. To increase vessel traffic in unpredictable and hazardous waters of the Arctic region will require 21st century waterway management in areas like hydrographic information, risk analysis and routing measures, proper edge navigation, and marine safety information. We must strive to provide tools that will enhance mariner situational awareness. Safe navigation starts with solid hydrographic information. There's a significant need for accurate and current hydrographic information in our Arctic waters. I keep telling Admiral Glenn from NOAA that I won't say that we're using Captain Cook's charts, but I definitely think there are probably some soundings from Captain Cook's charts on our current charts today. The federal agencies that are responsible for that information have a daunting task ahead of them, and the Coast Guard is supporting that effort. NOAA ships are working to map a proposed maritime corridor into the Arctic via the Bering Straits. NOAA and the Coast Guard will use depth data to ascertain the safety of the proposed maritime transit corridor. Overall, the project intends to collect about 12,000 linear nautical miles of data just this summer. In addition, although Healy's primary mission is not focused on hydrography for charting purposes, the Healy will coordinate with NOAA to acquire depth measurements and track lines while transiting other areas of the Arctic. Coast Guard has a layered approach for looking at navigational risks in waterways. That is PARS, PASA, and WAMS. The Ports and Waterway Safety Act authorizes the Secretary to designate necessary fairways and traffic separation schemes to provide safe access for vessels proceeding to and from United States ports. The Act also requires the Coast Guard to conduct a study of potential traffic density and assess the need for safe access routes for vessels. These studies are referred to as PARs. As I'm sure you're all aware of, the 17th District is currently conducting one of those PARs in that region. Even though it's titled Bering Strait PARs, it extends quite a bit past the Bering Straits, but I will get to that a little bit later. A Ports and Waterway Safety Assessment, or PASA, is a formal workshop which brings together local experts to analyze the risk in a particular port. The goal of the workshop is for the stakeholders to identify risks and develop non-regulatory mitigation options that can reasonably be put into place to further reduce that risk or meet new concerns or changing conditions. And finally, a Waterways Analysis and Management Study, or WAMS, is an aid navigation-centric look to ensure the current aid navigation system in place is adequate. WAMS have been completed in this area with the assistance of industry and local users and show that our current system is meeting current requirements. As activity increases, infrastructure develops, we need to continue to analyze that system and make sure it meets the needs of the sailing industry, shipping industry. On December 5th, 2014, the Coast Guard opened a six-month comment period on a port access route study, or the Bering Strait PARs, which originally started in 2010. The Coast Guard is conducting this study in part to devise ways to make commercial vessel traffic between Arctic and Unimak Pass safer, anticipating a potential increase in the amount of traffic. Based on comments received in 2010, the Coast Guard has developed a potential vessel routing system for that area. The routing measure consists of a series of four nautical mile wide two-way traffic routes coupled with precaution areas at conjunction points. The proposed routing measure are voluntary for all vessels and fishing vessels would not be prohibited within the two-way route. The purpose of this route closely mirrors current traffic. The proposed route closely mirrors current traffic patterns for the traffic between Unimak Pass and the Bering Straits. If the Bering Strait commercial vessel traffic increases, we anticipate the proposed route will minimize disruptions and increase safety for waterway users in the region because commercial cargo vessels would be expected to follow the published routes, not required, but expected to, and charted shipping lanes in that area. The comment period has closed, and our 17 district waterway managers are evaluating those comments as we speak. There are numerous harbor safety committees in the U.S. and have long been recognized as the key to safe and efficient environmentally sound operations. The recent stand-up of the Arctic Waterway Safety Committee is a positive step towards achieving those goals. The purpose of the Arctic Waterway Safety Committee is to bring together local marine interests in Alaskan Arctic in a single forum and to act collectively on behalf of those interests to develop best practices to ensure safe, efficient, and predictable operating environment for all current and future users of the waterway. So I'd like to speak for a little bit on the future navigation initiatives that we are developing in concert with other federal agencies and federal partners and waterway stakeholders. We're updating our delivery of marine safety information. On the left, you'll see an example of a PDF version of our what we call local notice to mariners from the Coast Guard, as well as other Army Corps and NOAA mariner notices as well. So right now, that's how the mariner gets their marine safety information is they have to go down, download it. They're looking through DH, somewhere between 64 and 100 something pages every week. On the right, you'll see what we're going to. We're going to an interactive, web-based, web pull and push marine safety information. This will allow equipment manufacturers for integrated nav systems on board ships to be able to pull back and grab the information required for that vessel's transit, or enable a person to go online and whether it's via a track line they want to lay down or via a box like you see up here pull out the marine safety information local notice to mariners pertinent to their area or their track line, as well as push the what I call time sensitive marine safety information, what we normally push over on broadcast notice to mariners via voice, over AIS, and we're going to leverage AIS very carefully over the next couple of years. So what you see down the bottom right is what we call port status, the physical oceanographic real-time system that is currently in 27 different ports around the U.S. It's a cooperative system between NOAA and local users, and it gives basically all the environmental data, tides, currents, air gaps for bridges, et cetera. We'll be able to push that out over AIS, as well as you see the far right, that's actually a Rose Point snapshot. Rose Point is an ECS provider, electronic charting system provider, and that's an example of information that could be ascertained over AIS, and that shows a buoy that's extinguished. So it gives you real-time information. Another thing we'll be doing is pushing out what we call AIS ATONs. They come in different forms, and I won't get into that right now, but we're using them. It's an electronic enhancement for our current physical system. On the left, you see this is Oakland Bay Bridge. We have five of the blue diamonds you see up there. Those are currently marking the Oakland Bay Bridge abutments, so that for large mariners, traditionally what they'd use is Raycon. As you see the dashed line there right in front of where that vessel is. It has a tendency to block out vessels on the other side, and very expensive, and sometimes don't work as well as they should. And those usually mark the center span of the bridge. For the AIS ATONs, these are actually virtual, we'll be able to mark the actual danger, which is the span of the bridge abutment itself. Up on the upper right, that's actually a screenshot from one of our Coast Guard cutters up in Philadelphia. That's actually what the AIS ATONs look like on screen. This was actually shot in March of this past year. When we take the summer haul out, which is usually normally a larger haul, and use a lit physical aid, and put in a smaller sacrificial aids of navigation because of ice. Normally those aren't as perceivable on the radar screen. They don't have the distance that a larger haul would. So having the AIS ATON still gives you that visual cue, even though it's still on the radar. Down the bottom right, that's a shot of the Pocomoke River, which is a small river or channel in the Del Mar Peninsula here just east of us. That's marked by some very small buoys in the winter, but the important thing about that area is that they have home heated oil and aggregate barges going in there in the winter. The extent of the ice this winter was farther down that Chesapeake Bay than the normal, pushed all those aids off station, and so it prohibited those commodities from moving into that port until we put discrepancy response. We put in these AIS ATONs so the captain's port could reopen up that waterway to traffic. So up in Alaska, we do not have any federal AIS stations. So we rely on a third party, the Alaska Marine Exchange, in a cooperative agreement, both on a contract to receive AIS information, as well as a cooperative research and development agreement to look at how we push out or transmit AIS data up in that region. And I'll show you a couple of other things we're doing as well. On the international side, as a member of the U.S. delegation to Arctic Council's PAIM working group, we are supporting work on the AMSA report recommendation 3B, which supports continued development of a comprehensive Arctic marine traffic awareness system to improve monitoring and tracking of marine activity. Through PAIM, the Arctic nations are exploring ways to share AIS data. So this is a snapshot, a screenshot from the Coast Guard cutter Healy this past summer. That black line up there, I don't know where, there if you can see it, represents the ice edge. So this is a very rudimentary tool that we were able to push out from the Healy. And this was rebroadcast over the Alaska Marine Exchange. Marine Exchange picked it up and the Healy rebroadcasted it. This is a snapshot of several AIS pieces of information. One was a pier, one was an AIDS navigation, and a couple other things along the north coast there. So it just shows what it would look like on a vessel that is equipped with AIS, an integrated nav system, or an ECS or an ECTIS that would show that, or an integrated radar system that would be able to show AIS. This is Kuskokwim Bay. As they were transiting past there, this is an area that has a lot of shifting shoals, very similar to our western rivers in the middle of the continent. And so what we showed here, and again, this is broadcast from Healy, that would allow us to put out where the current good water is by showing electronic ATON if there were no physical aids or physical aids were marking inappropriate water. So the important thing about the Healy experiment and pushing out AAS up in Alaska won't be done via ship unless it's necessary. But what that allows us to do is develop the technology, or technology's there, but develop a suitcase that allow us to go anywhere in the world that we have the ATON data, put it on any one of our ships, whether that be Haiti, whether that be New York after Sandy, whether that be somewhere in the Gulf Coast after a hurricane, or in Alaska, and be able to push out that AIDS navigation signal at any given time to get that port back up and running. It'll also allow us to push out any marine information, whether the Corps of Engineers or NOAA has found ridges or humps that the storm has caused that would impede traffic, or vessels that have sunk, or any debris that's on the floor. We'd be able to push out a signal showing the pilot and the master of that vessel where that debris is. So that's my presentation. I look forward to questions when we're up here. Thank you.
Okay, so could the panelists come up in the front here? And if people who would like to ask questions, if you could get in line by the microphones there. Again, people who are watching this event via webinar, you would tweet us at hashtag AskRFF. So I can start. I'll start while you're thinking about your questions. So I'm kind of wondering about the timeline for all of this increased shipping to actually occur, and what would drive that timeline. Is it the ice hasn't melted enough yet? Is it waiting for a deeper water port? Is it investment in, you know, palladium mines and other activities that would drive the need for shipping? Can we get some sense of that from the panelists? Yeah, anybody just
Sure. I mean, first thing, top of the list, of course, is the price of oil. I mean, that who would believe there'll be more tankers in the Arctic today, the price of oil being $40 a barrel? So I think when we did the AMSA, I know that many of you remember, price of oil was $147 a barrel. That was driving lots of activity. But it's not just oil. It's investment. It's technology. The sea ice retreat certainly does provide longer seasons of navigation, potentially. But maybe not year round though, so.
But the sea ice has been retreating. So sure. Is it about investment? I'm taking oil and gas off the table for the foreseeable future, as Shell says. But beyond that, do we need, knowing that shipping can help out these new activities, get their products to market? Are there many investments?
But you can't take oil and gas off because on the Russian Arctic, Yamal is being built, the facility there, and the LNG carriers, some of the largest ships in the world, be escorted in the ice by nuclear icebreakers. So that's Arctic shipping with the attendant impacts and challenges and investment and all of that. So Arctic shipping of oil and gas is still on the map. It's just that in the United States Maritime Arctic, Shell's not there right at the moment.
Yeah, I see.
So I think globally, it's still certainly a factor.
Madam Mayor?
We do see an increase in Arctic shipping. We also see adventure tourism, We have kite boarders, jet skiers, people trying to cross the Bering Straits, which is 50 miles from the U.S. side to the Russian side, if they don't get arrested by the border guards. So there is a lot of activity because the access is there now, and with the opening of the Arctic, there's more opportunities. A Crystal Cruise Line next year is a 1,000-passenger cruise with 400, 500 crew members.
Yeah.
So that's a first. Mm-hmm. So.
Wow. Any comments from you?
Yeah, I would agree with what's already been said. I think you're going to look at the destination shipping increasing as the requirement for those commodities. Comes to bear. I think you're definitely going to see an increase in recreational and adventure tourism and those things as the Arctic continues to be a very cool place to be. That's where you see the growth in shipping. You're not going to see it for the foreseeable future in any kind of transarctic.
But you want timelines, and everybody wants timelines, and they want numbers of ships at particular years. And if you know all about your great God and you know all about economics of every commodity, this is the challenge we had in the AMSA. Projections and forecasts are extraordinarily difficult because you start with global commodities and you're working down to a transport line. So
Yeah. It's
hard to do.
Hard to
but
do.
People want the numbers. I see numbers in this town, and they're all, if you swags, they're all guesses, not founded upon anything of reasonable, except they're correlated with sea ice retreat, of which we say, many of us, there isn't any correlation of that. But.
Oh, interesting. Okay, well, let's turn it over to the audience.
Yeah.
Please identify yourself.
Stephanie Kenny. I teach at the Maxwell School, and in my former life was one of the first official U.S. delegates to the Arctic Council way back in the 90s. So I commend everyone for the way that organization has grown, but it is perhaps a humbling lesson in the amount of time it takes for issues to come to the fore and mature. I was particularly interested in the number of times that black carbon was mentioned. And having been working on that in another context, I'd be curious to know what has brought it to the table in the Arctic context and what you see as perhaps the priorities, either for research or action. It wasn't quite clear to me every time it was mentioned that there is, in fact, a focused activity in either tracking, monitoring, or linking it to accelerated ice melt. If anybody could speak to that, I'd be very interested. Thank you.
Well, the black carbon comes from places like Norilsk. It doesn't come from ships, actually. But shipping black carbon from ships is being addressed by IMO today as a central issue. I mean, black carbon globally is clearly an issue, but for the Arctic, it's industrial sites that produce black carbon. And the handful of ships, which could be significant in the future, is an issue. In the protection of the marine environment and shipping, I have to say the black carbon is not number one. Mm-hmm. There are lots of other issues. But it'll come in time because we know IMO is addressing it as a serious issue today. I don't know, Scott, you know.
That's not my area of expertise, so I'm not sure I can add much to it.
We just would like more monitoring equipment in the Arctic. It's hard for us to apply for grants, and especially like a Tiger grant, and the one question they ask is, how are you going to reduce black carbon when we don't have the monitors there to take measurements, especially like in Nome and in our villages. So monitoring is real important.
NOAA is helping out in Yandings and
begging on them
some more
for.
Next.
I'd like to thank you all for your presentations. I'm Rob Hammett from Johns Hopkins. The mayor mentioned the potential role of for shell vessels to pitch in the case of an emergency, and there was, I believe, an article in the Alaska Dispatch News on the same subject. And so I was curious what your thoughts were on the role of private industry to provide some of this infrastructure, or is that pretty much the Coast Guard and the Army Corps of Engineers have to carry the lion's load on that?
For me, we need to look at all assets that are up there, both public and private, and continue to do working agreements. I think one of the most significant agreement is the Marine Mammal Coalition. The Alaska Whaling Commission and the oil and gas industry have a conflict avoidance agreement. I mean, that's a perfect negotiation with Arctic shipping and protecting our subsistence bowhead hunting.
If you're talking about commercial shipping in the Arctic, while most of the vessels themselves are icebreakers, I mean, all the world's like the shuttle tankers in the Russian Arctic, that's the mode of operation. But if you're thinking about escort of commercial ships in the United States maritime, think commercial. It's a commercial entity. The whole thing's commercial. Now, the response is Coast Guard responsibility along with the commercial industry. So the public-private partnerships is all there. But I don't expect American icebreakers to be escorting commercial ships that don't stop in America. So I think it's an issue, and I think there's a misunderstanding in this town on what U.S. Coast Guard polar iceberg or any polar iceberg really is. I mean, I just throw it out as a question for you all. But I think a lot of folks in this town believe we're going to create the Northern Sea Route as an Arctic waterway around the coast of Alaska, and I and many others don't see it exactly that way, but just to throw a grenade into the discussion.
Yeah, from the Coast Guard side, I also want to be talking about the polar icebreakers is obviously, as the President said, a need for our ability to ensure national security and make sure we can go where we want to go when we want to go, and then as well as a response a global response and be able to be responsive to any issue up in the Arctic when we need to. We do have a regime, and I'm not the oil response specialist for the Coast Guard. I'll stick to 8-ton and icebreaking. We do have that public responsibility, private responsibility for response to oil spills, as well as the regime that the Coast Guard oversees. So.
Next question.
Good afternoon. My name is Michał Łuszczuk. I am Fulbright visiting fellow at IRS in George Washington University. I am from Poland. And I have one comment and two questions. I start with comment to Major Michał. I would like to encourage you to influence the governments of the Arctic states to promote the problems you faced as a native peoples to the community outside the Arctic, because the knowledge about such things we presented today is very, very limited. And I think that it would be very useful and maybe helpful also to have some contacts with the institutions, organizations from outside the Arctic surface states to maybe somehow cooperate. And my two questions, first to Captain Smith, what is your opinion about the possibilities of the development of the cooperation, international cooperation of the Coast Guards of Arctic states? What are the chances or what are the obstacles? And the last question to Professor Biden, what is your opinion about the possibilities or the aims of Chinese activities in the Arctic Ocean in terms of shipping, tourism, research, fisheries, strategic issues? What can we expect from the Chinese? Thank you.
So I'll answer the possibility of the cooperation between Arctic Coast Guards. Is strong. I will tell you that this fall, I believe at the end of this month, there's going to be a meeting, the second real meeting of the Arctic Coast Guard Forum, and they're still in the development stage of what that's going to look like. I know we have a North Pacific Fisheries Forum, a North Atlantic Forum, but this will be a little bit different than those. We're hoping to gather all eight, and so all eight Arctic nations have agreed to participate. And start discussing what that forum would look like.
For China, I mean, it's natural resources and the carriage of Russian national and European natural resources to China is the number one driving issue. They're interested in transarctic navigation, but I think there's some not complete understanding on the Chinese, because I see maps with no sea ice throughout the whole year, and I say, well, I think there's a problem with the map that there's no sea ice, so it's seasonal. And how they can connect to Europe rather than the land side. Of course, you know that China has all kinds of activities going with rail to Europe. So that's a competitor to seagoing in the Northern Sea Route. So all bets are off, except one big bet is that clearly and plausible that natural resources and the search for natural resources around the planet include Siberia and connections to China.
Hi, I'm John Farrell from the Arctic Research Commission, and I'd like to continue the discussion on icebreakers. Admiral Zukunft is on record of saying he's asked for 6 icebreakers, he said, based on the high latitude study. And yet he's also said, we're not even in the game. We hear frequently from senior government leaders that $1 billion for icebreakers is a budget too high. Meanwhile, we're spending 55 to 80 on next range generation B-2 bombers or $400 million a year on military marching bands. So money is there, but it's not yet a priority is what it seems. So short of a catastrophe or an incident of national significance, what do you think it will take to convince the U.S. government that this really is a high priority need and it should be an icebreaker that fully owned and not private-public partnership type of icebreaker?
Well, I guess since I'm wearing the blue suit, I'll take that question. I think it was a very clear indication from the president's speech when he was up in Anchorage that the polar icebreaker replacement is a priority for the nation. I will let the acquisition folks and the budget folks figure out how we're going to pay for that. But I think there's definitely a clear need to replace at least our, at minimum, our current capacity. Looking at the number of 6, the high latitude study, they called for 3 heavies and 3 medium icebreakers. And I think we're going to have to take a look at how the traffic dictates the need for that. But at minimum, I think our minimum capacity right now would at least be 2 heavy icebreakers to ensure global access and really the national security.
Just 10 days ago, the Healy was at the North Pole. And 6 months ago, the Polar Star was breaking into McMurdo and providing presence of the United States down in Antarctica. That's the picture. We're operating, there are a lot of negative things said about the Coast Guard and the lack of icebreakers, but actually, our icebreakers have the full range of the planet this very year. So some of the arguments here in this town are not quite jigged. And it's the replacement of those ships, midlife for the Healy, end of the life for the Polar Star. And how many? 2, 3, 4, 6. But those are the responsibilities, and they're global, and there are no Arctic icebreakers, they're only polar icebreakers.
So we're running out of time. Last question here, and apologies to our tweeters.
Nick Snow with Oil and Gas Journal. Thank you for having this event, and thank you for assembling this particular panel, because I'd like to know how urgent it is for Nome to develop a deep draft port capability if the Coast Guard is going to respond to maritime emergencies in the Arctic.
Thank you. This is an urgent. We've been talking about a deep draft port for over 100 years for the Port of Nome. We continue to bang on it. And again, I want to address the gap in U.S. Arctic policy that identifies a deep draft port for Nome. The President mentioned it, supporting the Corps of Engineers project. But it's within the Corps' cost-benefit ratio analysis that identifies it to minus 28. So we're continuing to find ways, look at public-private partnerships on different opportunities to move forward, knowing that we're going to need partnerships on there. And we continue to work with our congressional delegation and the DOD, meeting with key folks to see how we can tie in. Because DOT uses it, NOAA uses it, the Coast Guard uses it. So it's more than just us. It's an international and a global need. Ships are going to keep going. They're not going to stop. It's going to continue to rise. And so the need is now. Thanks for asking that.
Why don't you give yourselves a hand for the questions and give the panelists a hand for their answers. Thank you very much for coming.